It is red, it has a cat on it, and after 2 years of development, I can't believe it's actually sitting here in front of me. The William Optics RedCat 71. Tonight, I'm going to photograph the Flying Bat Nebula, a target I've never shot before, using the Cat 71 so you can get a better understanding of how it works and the photos capable with it. Yes, the Cat 71 is finally here, and spoiler alert, I have no idea when this will be available. William literally texted me last week and said it's on its way. I assume there's a number of other units being tested around the world right now, but this is definitely one of the first. When I first made a video about the original Red Cat 51 about 3 years ago, my audience was very skeptical about this new kind of telescope. In fact, I remember someone made a half-hour video about how no one would want one and how stupid I am. Needless to say, the Red Cat is now extremely popular and well received in the amateur astrophotography community. It almost seems like it started the ultra wide field deep sky trend, and I've seen some incredible images taken with these things around the world. The new Red Cat is, you guessed it, bigger than the last one, 20 millimeters bigger to be exact. The Cat 71 has a 71 millimeter objective diameter shooting at a focal length of 350 millimeters at f4.9. Do those specs get you excited? They should. I'm sure a lot of Red Cat 51 owners agree that there are times when 250 millimeters is just a little too wide and a little extra aperture would be nice. And that's exactly what this is, the same ultra flat, color corrected Petzval APO you love with more power. You'll notice that the Cat 71 continues with the helical focuser design, but this time around the optics moves internally independent of the external dew shield. This wasn't an issue for me in the helical focuser in general. I actually really enjoyed it on the original Red Cat, but I know there are folks that will appreciate this subtle change. Another nice little tweak is the separate gear ring for an electronic autofocuser. A company called Deep Sky Dad made a custom electronic autofocuser for the original Red Cat, and I'd be surprised if there wasn't something already in the works for this one. William mentioned that the Strel ratio for this telescope was 0.95 plus, and I would imagine that a Strel report will be sent included along with this telescope when they start shipping. Attention to detail is the name of the game when it comes to William Optics scopes, right down to the custom printed Cat 71 bag. When the Cat 71 came in last week, I immediately mounted it to the Skywatcher EQ6R Pro and attached the 2400MC. This telescope has a large image circle just begging for you to put a full frame sensor on it. I've placed a Starizona filter drawer between the camera and the telescope, and inside there, there's an Optolong L Extreme filter. I'd love for my first light with the Cat 71 to be under a dark moonless sky, but that is not the case. There is a nearly full moon tonight, so I'll focus on collecting that strong hydrogen signal for now. Maybe I'll capture a hint of that faint blue O3 data with this dual bandpass narrowband filter, but from what I hear, the blue squid nebula inside of the Flying Bat is notoriously faint. So I'm really not expecting to see any of that object in my picture. You'll notice that I've mounted a small 50 millimeter guide scope on top of the Cat 71 onto the included cat style dovetail mount. This is an essential piece of kit that did not come with the original Red Cat version 1 anyway, and it's really appreciated. Since I'm using an ASI primary imaging camera and guide camera, I'll run the entire session on the ASI Air Plus on my phone. I've even tried to keep everything semi cleaned up in terms of cable management. I could really use one of those like corded style tubes that you run everything through. I'm always so hesitant to commit to one particular deep sky setup for an extended period of time, but I really feel like this one is gonna see me right through the winter. If you live in the Northern Hemisphere, my object selection should come as no surprise to you. The constellation Cepheus is in a great spot right now to collect some serious exposure time. I thought about shooting IC1396, the Elephant's Trunk Nebula, and the surrounding nebulosity. I've just done it so many times. I also chose the Flying Bat Nebula because it has a strong hydrogen signal, which is great for a moonlit night like tonight. The Blue Squid Nebula is an oxygen object within the Flying Bat, and it's extremely faint. It actually might be too faint to capture from my Bortle 7 backyard on any night. Here's my 5-minute exposure of the Flying Bat Nebula as it appears on the ASI Air Plus, the preview. I don't see any of that O3 Squid Nebula in there, but I'm not surprised. Pretty cool to see a new deep sky object in the preview frame. I knew it was a big object, but it's even bigger than I thought. It's funny, when I looked into example images of the Flying Bat Nebula and Squid Nebula for reference, I found Nico Carver's image, and he mentioned in his image processing notes that he used a special tone map to pull out the O3. That's an interesting approach, and it's something that I've kind of explored on my own, but I'd be interested to see exactly how he did that. I imagine that you really have to stretch that O3 data to the max to get it to stand out against that strong hydrogen signal of the Flying Bat. I've completed my imaging run on the Flying Bat Nebula and Squid Nebula. What I didn't realize is because where I'm set up, the object ran into my tree after about 26 exposures, 5-minute exposures. Still, I think that's enough data to produce a respectable image. I'm happy with the preview images I've seen of the Flying Bat Nebula through the Cat71. Everything looks great. We'll see how they actually look when I pull them up on the computer tomorrow. Since then, I've moved on to two different targets. It's almost 4 a.m. now. I shot the Tadpoles Nebula in Auriga with the Cat71, and now the Horsehead and Flame Nebula in Orion. It's almost, 4 a.m. So still kicking around here in the backyard, just taking advantage of the clear, cold skies tonight. So the Cat71 is taking images of the Horsehead Nebula right now, but I'm also imaging in the Black Dog Observatory the same target. So you can see the Horsehead and Flame Nebula captured through the Esprit 100 here in the observatory. The idea with this observatory is just to capture as much data as possible every chance I get, that instant setup. Okay, I've stacked the data captured with the Cat71 with darks, flats, and bias, so well calibrated here. Here's the stacked image open up in PixInsight, and I'm gonna do an auto stretch for the first time so you can actually take a look at it. Okay, here we go. Oh my goodness. Wow, look at that. Can you see the squid? I feel like you can just kind of barely see the squid in there. It looks kind of green though. Still, that's pretty good. So this is just 2 hours of exposure time. Pretty noisy still, but overall I'm happy with how this image looks for now. I'm gonna correct it a little bit. What do you guys think?
I'm gonna be honest with you. The Squid Nebula and the Flying Bat, for that matter, are not a 2 hours under a full moon with a one-shot color camera type of object. But I did my best, and I still love this shot.